before going to discuss regarding the different views of different chambers of the heart in different planes, it is very important to know the physics behind the ultrasound and the principles of ultrasound. And this knowledge will help us to do a better echocardiography and to improve ourselves. So as all of us know that sound travels in a particular medium in a linear fashion with a particular frequency and with a particular amplitude and with a particular wavelength. So ultrasounds are nothing but when the frequency of the sounds exceeds more than 20 kilohertz, that particular sound is known as the ultrasound. So it is actually not in the audible range, and the normal audible range of the sound is between 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, and when the frequency is less than 20 hertz, usually it is called the infrasounds. So similarly, like the sound waves, the ultrasound has certain characteristics that each ultrasound wave has a particular frequency, it has a particular amplitude, it has a particular wavelength, and the ultrasound wave can have power and intensity. So the basic which differentiate between sound and the ultrasound is called the frequency. So it is very important to know the frequency of the ultrasound. And as all of us know, the amplitude is inversely proportional to the frequency, and also the wavelength is inversely proportional to the frequency. So I am going to show you in two different pictures, that is, one is A and one is B. So what is called as frequency? So frequency is nothing but it is the number of waves in a complete cycle. So if we consider that this is the propagation of ultrasound waves and the cycle start from this point to this point, so if we see in the first picture, there are only two waves in a complete cycle. So here the frequency is 2, whereas if we see the B waves, we know if the cycle start from here to here, it has actually the 3 waves, and here the frequency is more compared to the A wave. And as the wavelength is inversely proportional to the frequency, so if we see in the A wave, the wavelength is more since the frequency is less, and in the B wave, the wavelength is less since the frequency is more. Now the same thing is being depicted here in this diagram, where in the A wave it is shown that the wavelength is more because the frequency is less. Here the wavelength is calculated from here to here, and similarly here we see that here the wavelength is still shorter since the frequency is more. So it is actually the wavelength which determines the penetration of the ultrasound waves through the different structures. So if the wavelength is more, the ultrasound beam is able to penetrate better to the deeper structure, whereas if the wavelength is less, the ultrasound beam is not able to penetrate to the deeper structures, and here the superficial structures are better visualized. And next is the intensity and the power. So when the ultrasound beam is being focused at a particular point, what it generates is basically the high intensity beam, and this high intensity beam can generate higher temperature in that particular area. That is why sometimes this principle is used for different purposes in the medical science, to generate heat wave by the ultrasound machines. So how a ultrasound is produced, it is nothing but by the simple principles which is called the piezoelectric effect. So previously we have discussed regarding the echo probe, and here it is an ultrasound probe basically, and we see that in this ultrasound probe the piezoelectric crystals, these are being arranged in a linear fashions in the tip of the probe. So this whole assembly is called the transducer. And the last lecture actually we have discussed regarding the parts of the transducer, the parts of the echo probe. So here I am just showing you the lens. This is called the lens, and above the lens the piezoelectric crystals are arranged in a linear fashions. So what are these piezoelectric crystals? Basically the piezoelectric crystals are nothing but they are the artificially made crystals made up of lead, zirconate, titanate. And what is more interesting about the piezoelectric crystals is that whenever they are being stimulated by the electrical signals, the piezoelectric crystals, they can undergo compression and relaxation, and because of this effect they produce a wave which is called the ultrasound wave. And this ultrasound wave can traverse the different and get absorbed and reflected by the different medium. Similarly, whenever this reflected beam, it comes to the piezoelectric crystals, because of the pressure effect the piezoelectric crystals can again undergo compression and rarefaction, and they can produce what is called the electrical signals. So in both the way, in one way this is called the direct piezoelectric effect, where the electrical signals are being converted into the ultrasound waves or mechanical energy, and in the reverse way, the converse piezoelectric effect, where the mechanical form of energy is being converted into electrical signals which is captured in the ultrasound screen. So this is a simple assembly of a ultrasound transducer or ultrasound probe. We can clearly see that this is the electrical connection or the cable which is comes from the assembly, and this is basically the damping material. That means it can decrease the speed of the electricity once it is generated from the cable, and the electricity can directly stimulate the piezoelectric crystals. Okay, and the voltage which is present in the electricity can directly stimulate the piezoelectric crystals, and these crystals can emit the ultrasound waves. So this is nothing but the same picture, but it shows the multi-element piezoelectric crystals. We can clearly see these are arranged in a linear fashion, and this is a better arrangements than the single unit piezoelectric crystals. So once the electricity, the electrical energy get converted into the mechanical energy in the form of the ultrasound beam traverses and it get absorbed, and some of the energy, some of the waves, they also get reflected back, and these waves are being captured by the lens which is present in the transducer. And again, the because of the generation of the electricity, this mechanical form of energy is being converted into electrical energy, and this transmitted to the your front panel of the monitor, and where we get a clear view of the different ultrasound images. So this is the basic principles of work, this is the basic working principles behind the ultrasound. So most important part is during the course of the ultrasound we can find that some of the waves, they can be transmitted, some of the waves they can get reflected, and some of the ultrasound waves can get absorbed also. And in the initial part we can see when the ultrasound beam comes in direct contact with any surface, few tiny waves they get scattered also. So this is very important, because if there is a more scattering and more refraction, so ultimately the strength of the ultrasound beam will decrease. So to prevent this scattering, what we apply is actually the jelly. So the jelly basically prevent the scattering, and it helps us or helps the machine to generate a large single strength ultrasound beam which can easily penetrate the tissues, and we can record the reflected waves. In this view, there is something called as resolution. So what is the resolution of the ultrasound? So resolution is nothing but resolution means how the two structures which is present inside the body, they can be clearly seen on the ultrasound screen. So better is the resolution, better is the visualization of the images. So we can't go to the details of this concept, but just for the sake of the knowledge, we should remember that there are lateral resolutions, there are axial resolutions, and something called as elevational resolution also. So basically, this is called the lateral resolution, where the two objects which are lying parallel to each other, they can be, how better they can be visualized on the ultrasound screen. And axial resolution is basically when the two beams or two images or two points which are there inside the body in a single perpendicular plane, they can be easily seen on the ultrasound screen. The last but the not the least about the ultrasound is called the echogenicity. So it is very important to know what is an echogenicity. So basically, echogenicity is nothing but it is the ability of the object to reflect the ultrasound beam with a strength. So there are if there are different surfaces, if one surface can strongly reflect the ultrasound beam compared to the other surface, then that object or that surface is called the hyperechoic. So as you see here, all the hyperechoic objects, they can strongly reflect the ultrasound beams, and they are basically represented as whitish dots in the screen. So structures like bones or high density structures, bone like structures, they can strongly reflect the ultrasound beams, and they usually appear white on the ultrasound screen, whereas surfaces which can poorly reflect the ultrasound beam, those surfaces are called hypoechoic, or those objects are called the hypoechoic objects. So one of the very simple example is basically the muscles or the superficial tissues, the interstitial tissues, the interstitial space. So these are called the hypoechoic tissues. But when the objects cannot able to reflect any amount of ultrasound beam, then those structures are called the anechoic, and they are being represented as black dots on the screen. So very good example is the air. So air look like black on the ultrasound, and it is primarily an anechoic structure, whereas bone or bone like structure or solid structures are called hyperechoic structures. So with this background, I think in the next series of lectures we'll move to see the different views of the heart from the different planes. And thank you for the patient hearing.